on up, brother. We want your uncles up today. Look too relaxed.
Good afternoon, everybody. I just want to give glory and honor to God, and I want to thank you all for being here. And I just want to give glory and honor to God in Jesus' name. And I just thank him for everything that he's doing. I want to bless all of the food that everybody's receiving today, Lord. Let it be nourished to their bodies, and let us all enjoy the food that we're about to get in our spirits today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, my brother. Come on up, Bill.
Thank you, Smokey. Good afternoon. I'm in 1 John today, which is faith in the incarnate Son of God, verses 1 through 14. Everyone who believes that Jesus is a Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves a father loves his child as well. This is how we know we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands. And his commands are not burdensome, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the ones who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. And the three are in agreement. We accept human testimony, but God's testimony is greater, because it is a testimony of God, which he has given about his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God accepts this testimony. Whoever does not believe, God has made him out to be a liar, because they have not believed in the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony God has given us, eternal life. And this life is in his Son. Whoever has a Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask for anything according to his will, he hears us. He hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we asked of him. Praise God for his word.
Amen. Thank you, brother.
You know, I forgot. I always like to end the reading with 2 Chronicles 7:14. And if this nation ever needed it, we need it today. Which goes, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and refrain from their wicked ways and seek my face, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. Praise God.
We can't humble ourselves, only the Holy Spirit.
You're right.
The bread
Clint Urschel Barbecue Commentary. Available.
That's Holy Spirit, man. That's not me.
To go to Singapore. And what I love about Dave, I love his humility. He never talks about what he's doing on the outside. He never boasts, he never brags. What I love about Dave is he's a team player. He's a guy of excellence, highly skilled, loves the Lord, and believes in lifting others. So I was very happy to hear that God had opened this opportunity for him and for his wife and for his team. And so they're on their way back, and it's going to be a long flight. Amen. But we pray for a safe return for him. Hallelujah. Me and his wife, Cheryl, we like to say that, Marcia, between you and Dave, we believe you're the prettier one. Amen. Hallelujah.
Now, I want to be sure the Lord told me that you never missed this.
Tell us about that commentary.
Available in hardback and paperback.
Amen. All right.
Woo!
Sometimes you just got to go with whatever's in your head, right?
I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on.
Oh,
shadow.
Come on up.
Heaven and home.
I was just sitting there thinking. You know, I played songs around them nightclubs. I had some great groups. But I don't know if any of them could talk to you guys just put on the day. You know, I remember when Bobby Bill Band, Johnny Taylor, and all of them would come sit in. We'd have some all-night parties. But none of them compared to this.
Amen.
Amen. Get a hand for the music anyway. Well, my brother's getting ready to get back on the road again, so I got him for another week. Come on up, Oscar. Back on that day. Come on up, brother.
Hang on, stay right here, John. I didn't come today to teach. I came today to get you to pray for me.
Okay.
And that's what I want you to do. For 2 weeks, I've had a mild case of vertigo, which is it's like being kind of drunk all the time. And it's time for me to go back on the road, and I was supposed to leave today. But I said, I can't leave until I come by and have you guys pray. I've been to the doctor, yes, for all you concerned about that, and he's doing what doctors usually do. I don't know. But see, I got a doctor that's greater than that. Hallelujah. And his name is Jesus. So I want you to just extend your hand and agree with Brother John and pray for me for this attack of the enemy right now.
Father, we know that nothing's impossible with you. Men practice medicine, but you're the great healer. And your words say, don't seek you for healing. Seek you because you are the healer. So Lord, today I just stand with my brother and I decree that everything in his body that needs to be adjusted so it can work the way you created it, be done right there in Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you for what you start, you finish. And nothing, God, have we ever asked in your son Jesus' name, believing at the time we ask, we receive, and asking anything that would honor and glorify you, we thank you, Father, that you would bless my brother with health, strength, energy, and favor. Wherever you send him, God, you'll be when he get there, you'll be with him on the way, and you're going to be with him before he leave. So now, Lord, I commit him to you for your healing power to do what only you can do, is heal our bodies in Jesus' name. Amen.
And Father, I pray for everyone who's here. There are many others who are still struggling in their flesh. Lord, I just ask right now that you'd like minister to their hearts and do what only you can do. You're the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Well, the word says, be instant in season and out of season. Amen. If you've got a Bible, turn to me to the book of Isaiah. I want to introduce my time together by revisiting a scripture we visited before. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, the basis of it was King Uzziah was an awesome man of God. He was a man who literally sought the living God. He wanted to be right with God, and he dies. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on the throne, high and exalted, and a train filled the temple. The depths of it is with that. When King Uzziah died, the prophet Isaiah was brokenhearted. He was brokenhearted, and he was so broken that he was literally crying out to God, and God had to tell him, says, son, there's no panic in heaven.
Come on,
Uzziah may be gone, but I'm still the Lord of glory, and it's still well. It says, I saw the Lord who was seated at his throne high and exalted. Verse 2 says this, and he had with him some seraphims, two wings. With six wings. With two wings they covered their face, with two wings they covered their feet, and with two wings they were flying. And they were calling to one another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory. At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the threshold shook, and the temples were filled with smoke. And then it goes on to say this. Verse 5. Woe to me. Woe is me. I cried, for I'm a ruin. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Bear with me now. It goes on in verse 6, it says, then one of the seraphims flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, see, this has touched your lips, and your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for. Now, I love this passage, and I've gone through it before, but there's a transition in this. Isaiah is grieved, he's hurt because Uzziah dies, and then the angel comes and he reaches on that altar and he takes his tongs and he takes his coal of fire, and then the whole situation turns because he starts coming toward Isaiah with this hot coal from the altar. And at that point, the title of the message is, what will you let the Lord touch? Because when that start coming at him, Isaiah could have gone, oh, no, man, this is way too freaky up in here, man. He could have turned and run. He said, no, there's some things in my life I don't want you to touch. But that's not what he did. He said, go ahead on and touch me, cleanse me, change me. Now, my question to you today is, what will you let the Lord touch? In 1975, I met a man named Dwight Short. Dwight Short is a Merrill Lynch broker. And he was a man who was sold out to the Most High God. And he had laid down his life for the sake of the kingdom of God. And I got news for you. He's retired now. But he became the leading broker in the Cleveland area because people knew he was a man of God. They knew he was honest. And they knew he would do right by them. And so they would bypass everybody else in Merrill Lynch to get to Dwight Short. Because he came to the point where he said, God, I'm not only going to let you touch my life. I'm not only going to let you touch my Sundays. I'm not going to only just let you touch my Bible studies. I'm going to let you touch my day-to-day, week-by-week, job, vocation, and everything about me. And he said he had a couple of managers that tried to fire him because he wouldn't go by with the little hustles that they had going on the side. He was an honest man, and he let God touch every single thing about him. The first challenge I want to make to you today is, what will you let the Lord touch? Will you let him touch your business? Will you let him touch every single aspect of it? The second thing is, will you let him touch your family? Now, Dwight Short has a Bible study that he sends out on Monday over the internet, and I got it last Monday. And this was the story that he sent out last Monday. In Nashville, Tennessee, during the first week in January 1996, there were 4,000 baseball coaches. What kind of coaches? Baseball coaches. They were meeting at the Opryland Hotel for the 57th annual convention. And while they were in line, the coach was saying, who's speaking? And one guy says, John Skolnowski is speaking. And he always does something great. And John was a great coach, and he coached for a long time. And it says, he walked to the front of this group, 4,000 coaches. And he's an older man now. He's in his late 70s. And everybody's a little concerned that he's a little senile. And so as they look at John, he walks up and he's got something hanging around his neck. It's about this wide and about this tall. And he doesn't say anything about this thing hanging around. He talks and everybody goes, yeah, man, John has lost it, man. He got something hanging around his neck. His mind is gone. And finally, he looked at him. After speaking for 25 minutes and not one mentioning the prop hanging around his neck, Coach John appeared to notice the snickering and everybody laughing. And even though he knew that these coaches were baseball coaches, he asked a question. He asked a question to these coaches. He said, how wide is home plate in Little League baseball? Does anybody know? Do we have any baseball coaches in here? He said, they were very reluctant. Finally, one kid went, it's 17 inches. He said, that's great. He said, how wide is home plate in junior high school and high school? It's 17 inches. He said, how wide is home plate in college? And the guy said, it's 17 inches. He said, it's interesting. In the pros, in the World Series, how wide is home plate? And everybody looked at him and said, Coach, you're kind of losing it. It's 17 inches. He said, it's interesting. Even in Babe Ruth's day, home plate was 17 inches wide. He said, even in the majors. It's 17 inches wide. He said, well, what would happen if a big league pitcher could not throw strikes over a 17-inch plate? What would happen in the big leagues if you had this super wealthy, big-time pitcher, he could not throw a strike over 17 inches? He said, what would you do? He said, would you widen it to 18 inches? Would you widen it to 19 inches? Would you widen home plate? And everybody laughed, said, no, I'd never do that. I'd never. He said, but what about this? What about when you have, let me get down here, I love this. He said, coaches, what would you do when your best player shows up late to practice? When our team rules forbids facial hair and a guy shows up unshaven, what if he gets caught drinking? Do we hold him accountable or do we change the rules to fit him? Do we widen home plate? And then he began to talk to him. And the coaches begin to chuckle. And he says this. He turns to the plate towards himself and he drew a Sharpie on the plate and he says, but what happens in your house? He said, when you could become completely harsh with your family. This is the problem in our homes today with our marriages, with the way we parent our kids, with the discipline we don't teach accountability to our kids. There is no consequence for failing to meet the standard, we widen home plate. Then to point to the top of the house, he added a small flag. And this is the problem in our schools today. The quality of education is going down faster, and teachers have been stripped of the tools that they need to successfully educate and discipline our young people. We have allowed them to widen home plate. Where is this getting us? He replaced the flag with a cross, and he said the problem in church is when powerful people in positions of authority have taken advantage of young children only to have such discipline wiped under the rug, under the rugs of for years. Come on, my iPad is messing with me now. He said, only to have this wiped under the rug for years, our church leaders are widening a home plate for themselves. For we allow it, and the same is true of our government. So we call representatives to make rules, but for us, they do not apply to them. They take bribes from lobbyists and from foreign countries. They no longer serve us, and we allow them to widen home plate so we and our country fall into darkness and abyss. And all of a sudden, everybody understood that crazy thing hanging around his neck. It was home plate.
Come on, man.
And his question to them today is, are you widening home plate? Have you decided it needs to be a little bigger because I've got somebody that doesn't fit in the 17 inches. I need to widen it so they can fit in and I can be blessed by them. Oh, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords says there's an accountability that is based on the Word of God. And we as believers need to walk in that truth and see that truth come to fruition in our lives. And so we can touch other people with that same truth. It's only 17 inches for me, for you, and for everybody else. Are we widening home base? It's always interesting to me. I was telling John, I went last night. I went to see my grandson play baseball, and he's 11 years old, and they're playing baseball, little league baseball. It's a wonderful thing. You ought to go. And the umpires are consistent, and I had to get that. The umpire were consistent. The plate in little league baseball is this wide. And as long as it doesn't go over his head and they don't roll it down there, it's a strike. But they all understand that. That's what it looks like. But my grandson walked up and he got two hits last night, and I was the proudest granddaddy you ever saw. You know? He was awesome. But I came here today to ask you a question. Are you widening home base? In Isaiah chapter, the same chapter that we were in, 6, verse 8, it says this, then I heard the voice from the Lord said, whom shall I send, and whom will go for us? You see, it gets to this interesting point, because in verse 7, it says, with it he touched my mouth, and he says, see, He has touched my lips, and your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for. God said, if you will let me, I want to touch every aspect of your life. But if you continue to widen home base and said, I'm fine, it's all right with me, God's cut me some slack, I've got a new boundary everybody else doesn't have, then you will never get to that point where you let God touch what he wants to touch. There's some things in our life that God says, I've got to touch. And if you let him touch it, he said, then I will cleanse it, I will purify it, and I will use you for my glory. He said, I heard a voice that whom shall I send? Who will go from us? And he said, here am I, send me. Isaiah goes from, woe am I, I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, to being touched by the living God, to coming to that point that says, here am I, Lord, send me. I'm the one you need. I'm right. I'm ready to go. Have you come to that point where you let God touch that thing that's deep inside of your heart, cleanse you to the point where you can say, Lord, here am I. Send me. Use me. Verse 9. He said, go and tell this people, be ever hearing, but never understanding, be ever seeing, but never perceiving. And after he had been touched by the fire of God, Isaiah goes from there and he says, I am the man who will make a difference. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2 says this, I gave you milk and not solid food because you were not ready for it. And indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. He said, I gave you milk. I gave you my word. But because there's some things you wouldn't let me touch, you are still worthy, still worldly, and you will not surrender things unto me. And then he closes by saying this, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not still worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For which one of you says, I follow Paul, I follow Apollos? Are you not acting like mere men? When I read that thing about widening home plate, it always amazed me that there was always one set of rules for everybody else, and there was another set of rules for the coach's son. There was always one set of rules for everybody else in the church, but there was another set of rules for the pastor's daughter. It always amazed me there was one set of rules for everybody else in the company, but there was another set of rules for the owner's son. And God says, if we live like that in the kingdom of God, then we're widening home plate. And we will miss the blessing of God. I want to challenge you today, and that's what this message from this coach said. Do you have a standard? Do you have a plumb line? Is that plumb line the word of God?
Amen.
And are you willing to walk holy with the living God and let him touch what he wants to touch? One of the hardest things in my life was to realize there's some things in my heart that God needs to touch. And if I will let him touch it, if I will let him cleanse it, if I will let him purify it, then he said, then I can use you. But as long as you're going like MC Hammer, you can't touch this, Lord. Don't touch that. This is all good. He said, as long as you're doing that, you're never going to be the man or woman of God that he desires for you to be. So my question to you this afternoon is, what will you let the Lord touch? One of the saddest days in my life is I had a guy who's a disciple. He's one of the guys that discipled me in those early days in 1973. And he got to the point that it became exposed that he had a hidden area of his life that he wouldn't let God touch. He was married, but he had a little thing going on with his secretary. And so he divorces his wife and he marries his secretary. Now this guy here, I've known him for years. He worked on one of the major ministries in the country. And he got mad at me and stayed mad at me for like 15, 20 years. You know why he got mad at me? Because I wouldn't go along with it and said, that's a good idea. I said, bro, I'm sorry. I will answer to the Most High God. I don't believe God got up this morning and said, I need for you to divorce your wife and marry your secretary. I don't think that was God. But when we won't let God touch it, we will believe the lie. Father, in the name of Jesus, today as warriors, we gather together in the presence of the Most High God. But Lord, for every single one of us, the desire is not to widen home plate. You have a standard. You have a holiness. You have a righteousness that you've called us to. And you've called us to literally be your echo in this world of the truth of the gospel. But we can't do that if we're widening home plate. We can't do that if we won't let you touch what you want to touch. Father, in the name of Jesus, everything in my life that you need to touch, touch it. Father, even as the tongues grabbed that coal from the altar and they touched Isaiah's lips, Father, touch with the fire of God what you need to touch. Because your plan is to touch us, to purify us, and then use us for your glory. Father, today, for every person within the sound of my voice, touch what you need to touch. And we'll give you all the praise and the honor and the glory for doing it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. For 43 years, Dwight Short was the leading broker for Merrill Lynch in Cleveland, Ohio. And when he retired, it was like the send-off of a pastor. Because you see, nobody had ever met an honest broker before. That was the title strung up over his retirement. An honest broker. Thank you, Jesus. What's going to be the banner over your retirement? Powerful man of God. Powerful woman of God. My challenge to you today is let the Lord touch what he needs to touch. Amen. Dwight Short. S-H-O-R-T. Just Short. That's all it is. Amen. God bless you.
One more time for our brother. You know, most times when you hear a testimony, people be talking about what God has done in their life. One of the greatest testimonies that I think we can give today is be honest and be transparent. I'm a little hoarse, but be honest and be transparent about the things that God is still dealing with in your life. We run a lot of people away from church because we act so holy and so righteous. And people get turned off by that. You know, I didn't decide one day to start having a Bible study in the restaurant. The reason this Bible study started, I was invited to a Bible study one morning. Every Bible study I went to, everybody seemed to be so righteous and holy, and I was the only sinner sitting in there. So I said, you know, Lord, I'm not going to any more Bible studies because I'm the only messed up dude in there. I can tell you right where I was. I was on the corner of Markenberg and 75. I'd been to the engineering club. Clint Merkinson, the Stoner Cowboy, invited me to come to that Bible study. And I saw all these wonderful businessmen. They were just raising their hand doing this. And Oscar, I was sitting back there trying to think, what in the world am I doing here? So I was getting ready to get on the freeway. And the Holy Spirit says, why don't you start a Bible study? I said, Lord, I don't know nothing about no Bible study. He said, you don't need to know nothing. All you need to do is just show up, and then I'll tell you what I want done. So I said, Lord, okay, if you really want me to do this, what day do I do it on? He said, Tuesday. I said, okay. What time, Lord? He said, 12:30. I said, Lord, what about 12 o'clock, 11 o'clock? Nobody wants to show up at 12:30. Sure enough, for about 6 months, I showed up. What used to be my club at my old restaurant. I'd go in the club, sit back there, and I said, Lord, I told you, wasn't nobody going to show up here. He said, I've got the one showing up. I won't. That's you. You just keep showing up. So I just kept showing up. And so one day my wife asked me, she said, do you really think you heard from God? She said, how can you have a Bible study to anybody but you? I said, well, Lord told me I'm the one he want right now. And I've had so many people to tell me about organizing, getting under some organization structure. That's not what God told me. I want people to come who don't know the Lord. I want people to come who think they know the Lord. And I want people to come who just searching to find what's really real. And when you come here on Tuesday, it will be real. Because I don't spend time trying to, I don't go out and call Oscar and say, Oscar, are you going to come speak? How about that, Paul? I don't never know who's going to speak. I just show up. Say, Lord, who you want to speak today? And you know, we've had people to get saved in here. We've had people to get delivered in here. We have people to get healed in here. Let me just tell y'all something. God don't need any of us to try to qualify anybody for him. He don't need that. And you know, if we would stop trying to pretend to be good, and realize we're not good. And the only thing makes us good is Christ in us. And he's not as good as he wants to be in us and through us, because we won't let him. Oscar just talked about that. You know, some of the things that God is showing me in my life now, it's not big things, it's little things. You know, I never will forget one night I went home and I just got through teaching a Bible study with my kids and my wife. And my daughter, she's a lawyer now, but she was saying at 4 years old, Dad, I'm going to be a lawyer. And every Tuesday, every Monday is me and her day. I have lunch with her every Monday. We sit and talk, and then it's whatever she wants to talk about. And so one day I was sitting down, and I got it about being truthful. So I get up, I'm watching a football game on Monday night. I'm sitting back down, I got my chair all kicked up. Big old glass of Kool-Aid, the telephone ring. My daughter says, I'm not going to call the name of the person called because I didn't particularly like him anyway. But anyway, she said, Daddy, so-and-so's on the phone. I said, honey, tell him I'm not here. She said, Dad, aren't you lying? You just told us about lying. Let me tell you something. I said, honey, hand me the phone. Another time, I was teaching on unconditional love. It's Monday morning. I was getting ready to take my daughter to school, and my wife was going 90 miles a minute. And I said, woman, don't you know? I got 4 meetings to go to this morning. I don't have time to talk. Can we do it later? My daughter walked up to me, and she says, Daddy, are you showing love to mommy? I said, sometimes you can't show love to this woman. And my daughter said, that's not what you said last night. You see, when we speak the truth, we allow others to hold us accountable to the truth that we speak. A lot of us don't like witnessing because our lives are so contradicting in what we look like and what we pretend to be. And if we witness too much, people's gonna start holding us accountable. You know, Bill, you know this. This is a story I'm going to just kind of tell you this. I had a guy work here, my cousin. He's in heaven now. I led him to the Lord. I discipled him. And one day, my cousin let a guy have his credit card. The guy wasn't charged a lot of money on it. And then the guy wouldn't pay the card off. And I got mad at my cousin because he wasn't doing nothing about it. So one day, my cousin came up to me. He said, can I talk to you? I said, yeah. He said, I know you've been angry at me. And I've been still being nice to this guy that charged all that money on my credit card, didn't pay it. He said, John, isn't that what Jesus did for us? Never again. I brought you that up to my cousin because he was right. Now here I'm his mentor. I'm the one discipling him, and he's telling me. See, when you share the truth with people, they got the right to hold you accountable to that truth. Hey, young lady back there, little blonde, come up here right quick. You, Judy, get up and come on. Don't be sitting back down there sliding all down, trying to pretend you don't know what's going on. Well, this is my oldest daughter right here. I mean, something happened to her, I don't know. But anyway, come on up. We got about 7 minutes. I want you to give a brief testimony, about what God's been teaching you. Just think about it. Don't get scared away.
I don't know, Smokey. I just got done eating lunch. I think life is just such a journey. And whenever we give up hope, God's always got, yeah. You can't hear?
No.
Can you hear better now?
Pointed towards me.
You know, we're always up and down. We're always in between. We're always somewhere. There's so many people around us. They need us. They expect things of us. We have all the things we expect of ourselves, and God is always there with us. We don't feel him. Sometimes we do feel him. And when you get in all those points, to just really realize that God is so big and he works through so many different ways in all of our lives when we give up hope. Maybe a new person comes in your life, maybe a new situation, a new doctor, a new idea. And it's just, life is just such a journey. And always focus on him, always go back to him, don't give up hope. Because like Smokey says, when hope stops, your faith stops working.
We've been in, what did you say, Jim? Do what now? Say it again, Tom. I can't hear you.
My friend Emmerich Copey, he's a man of God, and he's become a client and a friend. I'd like to have him lead the group and meet him.
What did he say?
We'd like to have a group. We want to meet the group and a group to meet him.
All right, come on up, brother. All right, Tom, I didn't know you got to stop using sign language, man. I won't hold it against you because you know Tom.
Say something,
whatever
you
say. Okay. Then
I'll let you close
that
with
breath.
I don't care what you say, man. I just
want to hear you. You
got a word? If you don't, we will take
you
outside and storm
you
till
you
get a word.
Okay, I'm not a good singer.
You're a singer?
No, I'm not.
Well, go ahead and sing.
I can't sing. Okay, my name is Emmerich. I'm a minister.
Oh,
I'm a minister of Jesus Christ. I love Jesus, and I'm glad to be here. And I like what she said because I was thinking about hope, the power of expectation, you know. And what she said is very powerful because today we're going through a lot of things in this country, in the world, you know, and people are losing expectation. And I was watching the TV 2 days ago. I heard this. This guy talking about because of what happened in this country, he no longer have hope. He doesn't believe anymore. And I was thinking about us as a Christian, what we're doing, you know, what we're bringing to the people who need to know Jesus in this country and all over the world. People are losing expectation, they're losing hope. And I was thinking about the woman who has the blood issue. She said something, and she saw something. She saw her healing. She saw that if she could touch Jesus, she received her healing. And she saw it, and she said it. And when she saw it, and she said it, and when she touched Jesus, something happened. And that's what I want to share in 1 minute today. I'm glad to be here. I don't know what you're going on today. The man of God came here, he spoke about your life. Be accountable about what you say every day. But I also want to talk to you about the expectation. The time become very hard every day. So maybe you don't understand well because I'm a French speaker. When I open my mouth, they know that I'm not from here. But I want to tell you something, that there's still power in Jesus. There's still power in the name of Jesus. There's still power. The Lord that we're preaching is still healing. He's still delivering. You know, he's still casting out demons. Hallelujah. So I didn't know that one day I want to be here. The Lord revealed himself to me and said, I want to send you far from your country, from your family. I say, Lord, where am I going? And 3 years later, I find myself in this country. Before that, he was showing me getting in a plane full of men of God. I said, Lord, where am I going? And I start talking about it. I start saying out loud what the Lord told me. I said, the Lord is sending me somewhere. I don't know where, I don't know why. And one day he revealed himself to me in my bedroom and said, I'm sending you far from your family, from your country, because I have something for you there. I believe in the power of Jesus. I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. And I believe that the Holy Spirit that make Elijah call fire from heaven is still the same. And in this day, we're still in the time of Elijah. He revealed himself to John the Baptist. And today, heaven is open. Whatever you're going through, I want to tell you something. There's still power in Jesus. Whatever this country is going to, the answer is not in the politician. The answer is not in the word, but the answer is still in the name of Jesus. God bless you.
Give him another hand, would you? Amen. Amen. You know, the train to heaven is like a commuter train. It's picking people up all along the way. But we all heading to the same destination. It don't matter how long you've been a Christian. It don't matter where you got on the train. The destination is heaven. And the reality is, the word says, let there be on earth as it is in heaven. What does that truly mean? You have to study the book to know. And then you don't call things as you see them. You call them as you believe them. And let me tell you something. Whenever something happened in our life that's disrupted, the first question we ask is why? Why does this happen? Why is it happening to me? The answer should be, the question shouldn't be that. Lord, what are you trying to teach me as you bring me through this? The word says, give thanks in all circumstances, for that's God's will for us in Christ Jesus. Lord, I thank you for what I'm going through. I don't like it, Lord, but I'm thanking you because your word says, give thanks in all circumstances, for that's your will for us in Christ Jesus. And your word says, all things work together for good. For those who love you have been called according to your purpose. Lord, I love you the best I know how, where I am right now. And Lord, I believe your word to be true. You said to watch over it, Lord, to see it be performed in my life. So I thank you, Lord, for my trial. Because in my trial, Lord, I'll come to know Jesus in a whole new and fresh way. Have your way in my life. Thank you for mercy and grace that will bring me through. And I trust you for what you're going to do in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. Have a beautiful day.
My name is Chris, and while y'all were talking and encouraging us, hope, I'm just thinking about hope, and I was thinking about Psalm 131:3, how God said to Israel, put your hope in the Lord both now and forevermore. And you know, when we go through things, if Jesus isn't in the center of that trouble that you're going through, it's really not trouble, it's really an opportunity, isn't it, to grow our faith. That's what it is, opportunity. It's not a problem, it's an opportunity. But when we put the Lord in the middle of that opportunity, he will grow our faith and we will have hope. But if we try to do it on our own, it feels hopeless because we're trying to do it independent of the Lord. And another verse that came to my mind when y'all were talking was Isaiah, I think it's 26:3. The Lord promises perfect peace. He's the Prince of Peace. He says that though you'll have perfect peace if you fix your thoughts on him, because you trust him. So when we fix our thoughts on the Lord, because we trust him, he promises, and he will do it, give you perfect peace. So no matter what you're going through, it's all right. It's an opportunity for the Lord to grow our faith. Amen? Amen. Thank you. God bless you.
All right. Greet somebody before you leave.